Well, I mean, exactly what that headline said in many ways, that this is... I've thought this all season, and that you look at United and you don't know what they... You don't know what they are. If you go back to the start of the programme and we're talking about Manchester City and saying Chelsea looked like Chelsea and City didn't look like City, that one of the defining things of any good club, any great team, or even good team really, is that they've got to recognise, they're recognisable. I mean, I've said this, that you could send Liverpool out in plain white T-shirts, and as soon as they started playing, you go, oh, that's Jurgen Klopp's Liverpool, and that's Thomas Tuchel. Same applies to Thomas Tuchel's Chelsea. Even
a Wenger team. You could tell it straight away.
Even David Moyes at West Ham, you look at the way West Ham are and the guys they've got in midfield and stuff, you go, oh, that's a David Moyes team. And with Manchester United, it seemed to me all season, I was sitting there looking at it thinking, but they're doing quite well. I've got to be missing something here, because you're looking at them and thinking, this just looks like what would happen if you got 11 good players, which they have got largely 11 good players. You know, they've got a shape. I'm not saying they haven't got a shape, but they haven't. It just looks so often that what they're just trying to get is Fernandes to put Cavani in, or Fernandes to put Rashford in, and there's nothing more than that. And I just look at, if you go back to when Solskjaer was at Cardiff, there were times when they played really nice stuff, but Cardiff fans will tell you that, you know, it was very erratic, and you didn't never know what you were going to get from one week to the next. And then guys that, you know, Neil Warnock and people like that came in and gave them more structure and made them more recognisable as, oh, right, this is what we do. And so that's where the analogy was.
McCarthy would be another one whose team you can recognise.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And they came in, and it just looks like, imagine if Cardiff just had really good players, it would have been a bit like this. This is how it would have been. And I don't even particularly, and that was another point, a strand of the column last week, that you don't even particularly blame Solskjaer for it, because it's not as if Manchester United have gone out and gone, this is a marquee manager, this we get this guy because this guy is getting to finals, this guy is doing this. They got Ollie, who had gone to Cardiff. They'd got relegated. When he left them, they were 17th in the league. He'd had success with Mulder, and that's good, but it's not a top standard European league. And so you think, well, what do you think was going to happen? This is basically, they haven't got one of these super... They went from Louis van Gaal, Jose Mourinho, and then Ole Gunnar Solskjaer. And you look at what the other two guys have achieved throughout, and it hadn't worked for them. It's not a logical progression. Ole came in because they thought everybody needed a lift, and he did give everyone a lift, because he's Ole Gunnar Solskjaer and he's a local hero.
That's tactics, not strategy. Yeah, sure. Yeah,
yeah. He is a lovely guy, but when you think about, if you think Jose Mourinho, he won what? Europa League, League Cup. Mm-hmm. And then when we got into next season, they were second, lost an FA Cup final. Lost an FA Cup final. Mm-hmm. But along the way, he was being savaged by all the critics. Mm-hmm. All of the Manchester United mob were on the telly giving him a hard time. Ollie gets a bit of a free pass, a very big free pass, because all these teammates are main pundits on TV. Keane, Ferdinand, Neville, Scholes, even to a certain extent, doesn't really savage Ollie himself very often. And I think if they were giving him the criticism that they would probably give to another manager if they hadn't been his teammate, then there'd be a very different feeling in the Man United boardroom about Ollie. But because they're, it's not really Ollie's fault. You've got to understand there's a lot of things they've got to do. We can see progress being built. He's brought in a good lad there in Cavani, you know. Once he hits the ground running properly next season, after what he's done this season, whoa, it's going to be great. But actually, they don't look at it logically either. They sort of defend their mate. And until you get away from that, I think he will survive.
And do you think, the closeness of the game, and it was decided by a goalkeeper penalty against a goalkeeper, it's actually put Manchester United, I think, in a quite tricky position, because Solskjaer can say we were that one kick away from having a European title to add to all the others they've won over the years. It's very hard for, I think, for the United board to be clear-eyed about it.
But Avon Grant was a penalty shootout. Yeah. He was one kick away from winning the Champions League.
Chelsea are a very, very different animal.
Very, very different.
How would we have looked at if Riyad Mahrez's shot had gone in right at the end when it scraped the bar with Man City? Yeah, you know, I mean, that's the way it goes. They lost.
Yeah, with results.
I mean, Mike McGrath and Ian Whittle are pretty well informed individuals. It looks like that United have settled on Solskjaer as part of the solution rather than part of the problem. I mean, that's not something that everyone believes, is it, Martin?
Well, I mean, you look at guys that are available at the moment. Antonio Conte, high maintenance, though he may be, is available and tends to go to places and win the league. Nobody thought that anyone was coming in front of Juventus again. For a very long time, and he has managed to do that. And he went to Chelsea at a time when everyone was thinking.
And oddly enough, Martin, you're talking about an identical situation where Juventus put Andrea Pirlo in charge of their expensively assembled group of players because he's a great man, does very good in front of cameras, and is a club legend, exactly like Solskjaer. But he had never managed a sweet shop, never mind the Juventus Football Club, and they were extraordinarily lucky to even scrape into next year's Champions League.
Absolutely.
It's an identical situation.
Yeah, it's a very similar situation. And you look at that and you just think that, for instance, the Erling Haaland, apparently, the Mino Raiola is going around Europe and he's sitting down with these clubs and whatever. And I'm not saying that the transfer will take place because Haaland's talking about staying at Dortmund now, maybe, and all of this. But the bottom line of what's being said is, you know, they're going and see this club, they go and see that club. And it's sort of like, well, you know, yeah, we know you've got a project, you've got this great big project, and we know you've got this marquee manager that you've brought in to fulfil this project, but you've all got that, and there's not a sheet of paper you can put between any of you. You're all offering us exactly the same thing. So what's the money like? And apparently they're the conversations that are taking place. But the interesting thing is, you can't say that at Manchester United. You couldn't go to you can go to Chelsea, you can go to Manchester City, you can go to Paris Saint Germain, you can go to any of these different clubs, and you know, we've got a marquee manager and we've got a 10-year project or a 5-year project or whatever, we've got Jurgen, you know, anyone. But at Manchester United, they can't say that because they haven't. They haven't got a marquee manager. They haven't got a guy that would walk into any major club in Europe. If Manchester United, if Ole Gunnar Solskjaer and Manchester United parted company, he wouldn't be on the list at Real Madrid at the moment. He wouldn't be on the list for Inter Milan. He wouldn't be on the list for Tottenham.
No, he wouldn't. You're absolutely
and would right. Harry Kane take the risk of going to Manchester United? All right, the only reason to leave Tottenham really is to go to another club where you're guaranteed to win trophies. Mm-hmm. And what does he think is going to happen at Man United? He's probably thinking, I'm not sure they're going to win any trophies. So
it is
even if I'm in the team.
It's fascinating, isn't it, that in the post-pandemic world, the clubs around Europe realise that they won't be able to shift players very easily, so they're shifting their managers back and forth, and therefore having a great manager. A good example is Germany. Not the bottom eight, the top eight. Seven of those clubs have decided, for whatever reason, or have been forced to, change their manager. The teams that have been successful are changing their managers. I reckon Barcelona will also change theirs. Real Madrid have got to change theirs. Mm. And so it goes on around the world. And so much as I don't like giving all the credits to managers, I want the players and the fans to be the thing that decides clubs' fates. At the moment, a lot of clubs' fates are teetering on who you point in those big jobs. And I'll be very interested to see if Manchester United do actually go down the road of a 3-year contract for Ole Gunnar Solskjaer.